tax collector. Tax collectors, publicans were known to be sinners because oftentimes they cheated people, keeping an undue percentage of the monies for themselves. And so they went to the temple, a good place to be, in the presence of God. The publican's only at the door, though, doesn't even lift up his eyes, he's humbled, because he realizes his sinful state, he don't know what his sins were. But it's enough for him to cry out, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, have mercy on me. And he kept repeating this, the simple prayer. The Pharisee boastfully comes to the front and gives thanks to God. It's good to give thanks to God, but thanks to God is really not thanks to God in this case, but it's a Pharisee patting himself on the back, telling God what a good person he is, that he's not an adulterer or murderer, that he's not a thief, that he fasts 2 times a week, that he gives tithes of everything that he has. And so he gives thanks to the Lord that he's exceptional. And he does this by praising the Lord. But the praise that he's given to the Lord is not accepted by the Lord. Because, first of all, he's full of pride. He doesn't realize that if anything he's accomplished is by the grace of God, the help of God, and not by his own mere doing. Worse than that, he thinks that he's achieved perfection. And worse than that he condemns this particular man, says, I'm not like others, like this publican here. And so he makes a judgment of the other. The parable is very simple for us to understand, that we need to be humble because we're sinners and identify with the publican. We should not be like the Pharisee and be prideful in what we spiritually accomplish. But when we progress in the spiritual life, the temptation is, because we see ourselves in relation to others, we think that we're doing very well, and we become full of pride. We say, Lord, at least I'm keeping the fasts. At least, Lord, I'm going to the church more than others. But I'm doing this, I'm doing that, and we kind of think, through the temptation of the devil, who encourages us to think in this manner, that we're okay before the Lord. And so, not only do we think we're okay, like the Pharisee in the parable today, but even worse, we begin to look at other people and see their shortcomings, their weaknesses, what they are not fulfilling, and we make a judgment call about them in our mind. And so in any spiritual activity that we do, if it's prayer, if it's fasting, if it's service to others, if it's singing in the choir, if it's serving in the altar, if it's giving food to the poor, if it's giving tithing to the church, whatever it is, it all has to be cultivated in humility, which means simply to do it for the love of God, and not for merit. Not that we gain a special status before the Lord, but our status before the Lord should always be one that's grounded in humble-mindedness, in service, in love, and recognition of our own sinful state. Today is the beginning of what we call the Triodian period. The Triodian period begins today, this year, January 28th, and it ends on June 3rd. That's 117 days. That's 19 Sundays in a row. It's governed by this book called the Triodian. The Triodian is a liturgical book. It means the thrice odes, the three odes. Many of the canons were done in three odes, and so it's given that identification. Like the Bible is a book. It's divided into two parts, the Old Testament and the New Testament. Well, the Triodian is divided in two parts, called the Lenten Triodian, and then the Flowering Triodian, also called the Pentecostorian. In other words, from this day until the eve of Pascha, which is April 8th this year, from now to April 7th, that there's a certain part of this book which will govern our spiritual lives, that will talk about repentance, of coming back to the Lord, of understanding what the Lord has done for us. And then the second part of the book begins Pascha and ends on the Sunday of All the Saints. And so this is a great period of time. It defines the whole liturgical year, as it were. Now we're in this, what we call the pre-Lenten season. There's 3 weeks now before we enter into Lent itself. And then comes the Lenten season, a of the 40 days, and then the great and holy week, and then the Pascha, and then the 50 days between Pascha and Pentecost, and then finally the Sunday of All Saints. This is a blessed time for us. It's called today the announcement, the proclamation of the Paschal season. That's liturgically what it's called, the proclamation of the Paschal season. Now, Pascha doesn't just mean resurrection of Christ. Pascha means Passover. It has to do with the whole content of preparation and fulfillment, that we prepare for Lent, and then Lent comes, and then we have the celebration of Christ crucified, buried, risen from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sending the Holy Spirit. All that is given to us in the context of what we call the Trinitarian time. In contemporary understanding, however, because we're weak spiritually, not only weak spiritually, but we don't even understand what this period is about. But for many of us, when we talk about Lent, when we hear the word Great Lent, already it's a turnoff. We say, well, Lent's coming. No more meat, no more dairy, more services, prostrations, no entertainments, that we keep a Lenten style. Supposedly we do all this. And so for many, it's like we're going to enter a period now of spiritual suffering. We're going to be hard on ourselves because that will please God, because we're sinners. And so we'll offer up something, we'll give something up to the Lord that he will be pleased and accept us. And so in this pre-Lenten season, when we hear the announcement that Lent's coming, that for some it'll be dreadful already, that they say, oh, the deprivation that will come. I'm not looking forward to this. This is a period, it's not joyful. But spring's here and we're focusing on the suffering of Christ. We're suffering on ourselves as sinners. And then when Lent comes, that dreadfulness we have of being deprived of something, that's being enacted. And so we have to suffer through those 40 days as it were. And then finally, Pascha is for us, well, finally it's ended. Now all that fasting is done, all those extra prayers are done, the good works are done, and now we can get back to life as normal. And so we celebrate the end of Great Lent. Of course, that's a misunderstanding, but it's very popular in the psyche of many people. It's because they really don't understand what the Triodian period is about. It's about taking our life serious and living out the content of our spiritual life. It can't be reduced to spiritual, liturgical, practical policies and practices. Although those things are very important, it's super essential that the Lenten prayer of St. Ephrem accompanies us. It's paramount that we go to the Holy Confession and Holy Communion during the Lenten season. It's extremely important that we fast and we pray, and that we're more serious about our life, and that we cut ourselves off from what is extraneous, from all the pleasures and temptations and everything that is of the world, and focus more on our spiritual life. Well, that is very important for us. But it's not to do it for the sake of doing it, and then at Pascha we say, it's all done, and now let's go back to living our normal everyday lives. It's not the purpose at all of what this endeavor and this blessed time is. That is for us to understand and to participate more fully in the life that we have in Christ Jesus. In the language of Apostle Paul, he would say that in this period of time, we're called to walk in a way that is pleasing to the Lord. When we walk, we go somewhere. And we're going to a certain point, but there's a certain place that we have in mind. And wherever we go, not only physically, but spiritually and psychologically and emotionally, that we're walking in a way that's pleasing to the Lord. That we bear fruitfulness in all our good works. That those things that we do, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the glory of God the Father, that it bears spiritual fruit. That we're not fruitless, but that we're bearing something. That we're producing fruitfulness before the Lord, spiritually good things. That we grow in the knowledge, the true knowledge of the Son of God, knowing truly who God is and being faithful to Him. And all that is given to us in these 117 days, 60 days Lenten, 57 days celebratory, Pascha, is given to us so that we could renew our lives spiritually, And so the rest of the year is given us to maintain that new plateau spiritually that we have striven to attain to. To be sure, this time of the Triodion is a blessed time that all the liturgical fathers that tell us in their writings, the spiritual fathers, they tell us that in this time when we endeavor to be more serious about our Christian vocation, that the grace of God is increased in due measure for us. That it's the season, as it were, where the abundant rains of the grace of God comes upon us. So we make some effort, and God himself makes an even greater effort for us. Lent is called Lent in spring. What happens in spring? Well, in spring there's a renewal of nature. But when nature is renewed, there's work for us to do. That we have to go into our yard, we have to go into our garden, we have to do things. We have to uncover things, we have to clean things up, we have to get rid of weeds and rocks and things. We have to start again that garden. The hard soil is broken now in the springtime. And then the warmth comes and the sun comes. And that we do our work, we do our part, we clean up, we weed, we prepare, we put the seed in, and then God does the rest for us. The result of that is there's fruit. The result of that, there's flowers. The result of that, then there's a wonderful garden that we could enjoy. It's the same thing with us in our spiritual life. But the Lenten spring is a time for us to be spiritually renewed. That the bitterness of winter has gone away, as it says in the hymnology. That the warmth and the gentleness of the spring has come. And as nature is renewed, we're called to be renewed. And so we have to keep this in mind as we approach the Great Lent. But now is the time, now, in the pre-Lenten time, our Holy Mother the Church says, listen to the calling, the proclamation. The Great Lent is coming. And start to prepare how you will fast. Start to clean out your refrigerator. Start to think if you know what prayers are there, how you could increase the measure of your prayer life. Think about those things that you don't need to do. If we're bombarded by the world and everything in the world, and keep up all the entertainments and all those kind of things that are heavy on us. We're tuned into the world and not tuned into the kingdom of God. There's no room then for spiritual growth. So we have to cut things out of our life for a measure of time. And all this requires some preparation for us. In a few Sundays, we'll have the forgiveness rite, where we embrace each other and ask for forgiveness. And yet we know even before that, in our households, among our friends, in our family, that already we have to address that. If there are kind of difficulties, things that need to be resolved, things that need to be ironed out, that we need to be at peace, we need to get everything in order so that we enter into the holy season of Lent fully equipped, walking rightly in the way of the Lord. All these things are for our consideration. It is to be said, though, that many people never get aboard the train of Great Lent. They stay in the station. But they get on and they jump off at the very next station. That they're overcome. They say, oh, it's too much. I can't do this. Or what they want to do is they want a Lenten that is Lenten light, L-I-T-E. Not so heavy. That they take a little of it. In other words, instead of really trying to fast, there'll be a symbolic fast. Instead of making a sincere confession and receiving the Holy Eucharist, there would be a confession, but it'd be like that mandatory visit to the dentist that you don't want to go, but you know you have to go. And all that is unbecoming for us. And so we have to begin to understand this great blessing of the period of the Triodion that comes upon us, so that we can now prepare for the beginning of Lent. And then when Lent comes, that we enact and engage those things that we're preparing now, those disciplines that we need, and engage in those, and preserve in those. And then when the Pascha comes, we celebrate. We celebrate what? We celebrate that through these practices, by the grace of God, that we're a little stronger in our faith, that our knowledge of God is more deep, that our fruitfulness in our spiritual life, in our relationships with others, that it's more real and more secure and more loving. All this is given to us. And so let us accept this proclamation today. And many of us probably didn't know that there was this proclamation today, but it's always on the publican and Pharisee Sunday, this proclamation of these 117 days that will be guided by this book called the Triodi. Let us prepare ourselves in this pre-Lenten season so that we can enter the Great Lent by the mercy and love of God, reconciled to one another, and zealous for those good things in the works of the Lord. Amen.